Hey everybody, welcome to 3 Minute Thursdays, your source of Family news and gossip packed into a short, sweet 3 minutes on everyone's favorite day, which of course is a Thursday. Today we're talking about something that I think animal rights activists and vegans are pretty good at, but I think we need to get better at, and that's storytelling. That's shifting the narratives, that's changing the narratives. That's the idea of pulling back the curtain to reveal to people that what they see time and time again isn't always the reality of the situation. All right, go ahead and hit that subscribe button, turn on the bell notifications, follow along on these great places. They're a blast. This month we gave $2,676 to Ernesto's Cat Sanctuary in Syria, who's doing a lot of great work over there. They have like a sanctuary for like rescued cats. They have like 1,800 cats or something like that. A separate sanctuary for dogs and farm animals, and they also have a free vet clinic. Felt great to be able to send them that much money and support them. If you want to join us for as little as $2 a month, you can. Okay, so this is something that I think we often overlook as activists when examining our tactical toolbox. We look at our abilities to educate. We look at our abilities to protest, to organize or design, write, fundraise, that type of thing. But what we often don't consider is our ability to tell a good and complete story. One that not only challenges the current narrative, but successfully disrupts it. And that's hard to do, but ultimately, I think that's one of the biggest and most important things we need to be able to do as change makers, is we need to be good storytellers. Because at the end of the day, like our top level goal isn't trying to stop people from eating animals or close this place or that place down or get a policy in place. It's about changing the narrative. It's about shifting the narrative away from one of propping up speciesism and moving it towards one that tears it down. And the bad news is we are up against some of the biggest and best and most well-funded storytellers there are. Big business and the advertising agencies they hire. We as activists, we are tasked with getting people to look beyond the narrative that is woven into every fabric of their lives. The narrative that people are told that animals are here for us to eat, that we need their flesh and secretions to keep us healthy and strong, that we need their skin and fur to keep us warm, that we need them to find us new medicines and cures, and we are even sold the story that we need them to provide us with a laugh at their expense. It's a masterfully crafted story that has been told to us for generations after generations by people who want to make trillions of dollars off the suffering of animals, and now it is up to us to break that cycle. It's up to us to get people to see beyond what they've been told and look outside of the box, to see things in ways that they haven't seen those things before. And I think ultimately this is where we stumble as a movement, right? We definitely have some good storytellers, don't get me wrong, but I'm not sure we have crafted our stories well enough to break through the current narrative and successfully rewrite that narrative. Or perhaps we love our story so much, the idea of changing it up or questioning it or tweaking it isn't just seen as a bad idea, but it's almost seen as traitorous. So some stories popped up on my radar the last couple weeks that I think really kind of illustrate this idea of like what we are focused on with our story and all the things we're missing outside of our framework that I think is just, if not more important. So I think Germany, for instance, is a really interesting place in this storyline. And I'm really interested to see how it'll play out over the next few years. But it was recently reported that eating of meat per person has dropped from 138 pounds per person in 2011 to 121 pounds per person in 2022. First off, that's just disgusting. 121 pounds of animals inside of you. That's just, I can't even wrap my head around that. And that those are actual like living, caring, sentient beings. It's just like, but also a downward trend is a downward trend. And let's hope that it keeps up, right? Now this was celebrated by a lot of vegans and activists, and I understand why. It's a positive trend. We saw a lot of posting about this on social media. But what happens when we step back and look at that story from a couple of different angles, equally important angles, like from an industry perspective? This is not good for them. The number of animals slaughtered for meat has dropped. But also, pulling back, according to the most recent data, Germany is the fourth largest exporter of animals in the world. So currently, as the number of animals being consumed starts to drop, Germany isn't like at a loss in what it can do with those dead animals. But naturally, there's more. New Zealand lands in second place as the world's largest exporters of animal products, with milk, sheep, and goat rounding at the top of their list. But they also recently become, I believe, the first country to ban all live exports. This is a big deal. Like, this is something that has been fought against by animal rights activists for decades, and New Zealand has finally made it happen. So nice job, y'all. But a huge percentage of their export isn't alive. For instance, they export roughly 95% of all the milk they produce, and it's New Zealand's biggest export earner. That seems like an issue that won't be solved by banning live exports, and I don't think it'll be solved by creating a whole bunch of New Zealand vegans. But back to Germany, because they have also stated they will ban all live exports to countries outside of the European Union. They currently export 315 million animals a year as of 2019 within the EU, 9 million animals outside of the EU. They are saying unless there is a ban agreed to across the European Union, their German ban just doesn't mean that much. But what about all those people who are not eating as much meat in Germany? Coupled with a rise in plant-based sales, things seem to be looking up a bit. Or so it seems. This storyline always seems paradoxical to me, coming from vegans, because yay, less animals are being eaten in Germany or other countries that celebrate these falling numbers. Like, it's a good thing, but it's not dropping because we have created more ethically based lifelong vegans. It's because there are more people concerned about climate change and the role animal ag plays in it. So they become reducitarians or flexitarians. And that seems contradictory to all the rest of our politics. But let's not forget that reducitarians and flexitarians, by definition, they can't exist without animals being killed. The philosophy being pushed in that flexitarian world can't exist without animals being eaten. So Jake, what in the hell is your point? I hear you. Great question. I think I'm getting to one. So let me give it a shot. Let me see if I can wrap it all in. We animal rights activists and vegan activists are telling a story. We are weaving our narrative, and its focus and depth, the complexity is very narrow. If you know about animal use and you don't stop participating in it, you're an abuser. If you do stop your participation, together we will topple animal use by shifting demand. And yes, it's often good to be direct and to the point, but we can't simply disrupt that very small piece of that bigger narrative and expect that to topple over animal ag, to topple all those other narratives. It's just not realistic. We need to be disrupting big ag's story and replacing it with our own on all levels. From the individual, to the producer, to the distributor, to the boardroom. And I made a video about this a while ago. It might be worth checking out if you're interested. And just to be clear, this isn't a call to like change the definition of veganism or what it is or what it means. What I'm suggesting is that our story means so much more than stop using animals. Because in order to stop using animals, we have to look at the much bigger story behind the one that's just on our plate. It's amazing that people are eating less animals. I'm happy. But those people are still eating 121 pounds of animals each and every year, regardless if you dress them up as flexitarians or reducitarians. And as they hopefully eat less, it doesn't really slow down countries from shipping animals off to where people are eating more of them. And when that happens, a first step in combating that are export bans, which are popping up in places like New Zealand and Brazil and Germany, which is also great. But then we have to take into account subsidies and taxpayer money being used to help these industries if they have a bad year or a bad few years or a bad decade or two. So as we start to see little and exciting changes like these, we have to remember the big story that we are trying to tell people and remember the narrative that we are trying to disrupt. Because it's not as simple as if you stop, and you get two of your friends to stop, and they get two of their friends to stop, then we'll force their hand with our buying power. There's so much more at play here. And when people don't get the full story, I think they feel disillusioned and eventually move on to something else. I think their morale is being crushed when they find out that their hard work isn't just going up against, you know, an individual, but the full budget and force of governments and industries and ad agencies. It's the overwhelming feeling of being outnumbered and outgunned. So not only do I think we need to become better storytellers in order to explain our theory of change to individuals and how we can actually disrupt the narrative of these massive industries, we need to figure out how to craft good stories and make sure they're disrupting these places across the board. Because we aren't telling a short story here. We are telling a huge novel, one with compassion and love and murder and action and lots of acts and storylines and complicated characters interwoven amongst one another that needs to be all sorted out. We need to be able to tell this story to the public to get them to join us on a long journey, not just a paragraph or two to get them to switch what's on their plate. And finally, we need to be able to sit down and plan out this story. We need to know the ins and outs and not just the bullet points. We need to be able to look outside our own boxes and blinders and look for alternative endings and creative narratives that address the much bigger issues and problems. And then we need to figure out how to successfully interject them into all the aspects of the industry, not just the individual. And it's not really until we figure out that story and how to effectively tell it that we can successfully continue to keep fighting.